wrestling fans of the world. You are listening to the Flying Gaijin Bombcast, coming to you from the stormy shores of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. I am your host, Zachary Randall. And with me, the five-time wrestling podcaster of the year, Mad Matt Thompson. Maddie, how you doing?
Doing swell. Can you dig that, suckers?
Good. Well, we've been gone for a little bit. And you know, Matt made a very heartfelt post on Facebook that he was dealing with some family stuff. I'm here to give you the real scoop, though. He was throwing a little fit about the Cavs pissing away Game 3 against the Warriors. He didn't want to admit it, though. So anything else you might have heard is really just him throwing a bitch fit.
That didn't really add to anything. Like, that just made things a little bit worse. I'm not gonna lie.
That didn't.
Oh God. I don't want to have to look at Draymond Green until next June. Like, can we just let that happen? Like, I do not want to see his face until next June 1st.
Well, the nice
meet up again, hopefully.
Who else are you gonna meet up with? You know, I mean, who else is gonna be in the finals?
Yeah.
You know, I think it's a testament to, I saw somebody say that basically, like, LeBron couldn't be the greatest ever because, he's lost the finals 5 times. And it's like, first of all, he's been in the finals 7 fucking years in a row. And for the record, I think LeBron James is unquestionably the best basketball player ever. And you're talking to a guy that grew up watching Michael Jordan and Larry Bird and Magic Johnson and all those guys playing. So I've watched a lot of basketball in my life. And then also, for the record, my favorite player ever is Dwayne Wade. So it's, you know, it's like, I think there's a little bit of objectivity on my part. So number one, getting to the finals 7 years in a row, and at times doing it without a ton of help. Obviously, like, the Heat teams were super loaded, but that his last year in Miami, he was getting no help from anybody else in the playoffs and in the finals, which is why they got swept out. And then he hasn't always had a ton of help from these guys on the Cavs. So, you know, what are you going to do? I think it's the fact that they won that game by as much as they did and then hung close in the last game is a testament to what a force of nature he is. So losing is never fun, but nobody was beating this Warriors team.
No, and I knew that going in too. It was just, you know, it was obvious that any sort of effort they put forth was going to be commendable. And it's just, you know, it's just so unfortunate that people don't see, like, just the intense physical specimen that LeBron is. Just that alone is enough to make him the best ever. Like, his athleticism is just beyond anything I've ever seen.
Well, I mean, you know, and we're going to, and never, don't worry, everybody, we'll move on to talking about simulated sports here in a second. But, you know, athleticism, LeBron's a freak. No two ways about it. Genetically, physically, is a freak. But there's been a lot of guys in the NBA that are, like, athletic. I mean, dude, Vince Carter's a freak. He's still playing at a fairly high level. And, of course, you remember when he had, you know, he was supposed to be, like, the next Jordan. Well, his athleticism wasn't enough for him to be a Jordan-level guy. LeBron, beyond being crazy athletic, is an amazing basketball player. If you actually start breaking down his game, he is just phenomenal.
Yeah, I mean, if you just look at, you know, the amount of assists per game, and it's just, as you know, the amount of court vision that he has is insane. That move that he pulled in the I think it was the fourth game where he bounced it up off of the backboard to prevent him from traveling and get his own bucket, like, you know, dunking it right back home. That was awesome. That was some NBA Street shit for those of you who remember.
That was a great game too. NBA Street series. So it was NFL Street. Anyway, so enough basketball. That's not why anybody is tuning in here, is to hear a LeBron James love fest. So we're here to talk about New Japan Professional Wrestling. So we're going to do a little bit of a special episode this week. We are not going to be traveling into the past much more than a few days. we are going to be talking about the Big Dominion show from this past weekend, which is, if you want to put it in American wrestling terms, you would compare it to WWE SummerSlam. It's the second biggest show of the year next to Wrestle Kingdom, and they've been building up to it since the beginning of beginning of January, since the Wrestle Kingdom show. So we're going to recap that. We're going to talk about what New Japan has coming up with their Kizuna Road tour, which is starting up soon, and then the two G1 specials,
which you will be attending, Mr. Yes, Fancy Pants.
Yes, I will. Mr. Fancy Pants right here is spending 5 days in beautiful Long Beach, California.
Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, if you don't run into Snoop Dogg, I'm going to be pissed.
Okay. Well, I'll keep an eye out for him. I'll see if, I got friends out there, and so does Angie, so we'll see if anybody knows. What's Snoop's real name? It's like Calvin Brodus?
Yes, Mr. Brodus. Yeah. Yes.
All right, so before we jump into this, I got to offer up a slight critique of some of my other podcasters, people who are much more famous and successful at me at this whole podcasting thing. But I got to offer up a criticism, because it's actually people I like and I'm fans of, but I just have an opinion that I completely disagree with, and I think you do too. So listening to both Dave Meltzer and Todd Martin talk about the Dominion show, and they're obviously two of the preeminent voices in professional wrestling analysis, they both seem to think highly of Don Callis. And you know, I'm glad to have English commentary on New Japan World. Don Callis, in my mind, is not any good. He's learning the product, which helps, but he's doing the outdated heel gimmick. And to a certain extent, he's doing the Jesse Ventura heel gimmick, whereas it's like, I just like people that cheat, because apparently cheating in and of itself is a virtue, and not winning fucking wrestling matches. His humor is incredibly sophomoric, and he needs to learn how to speak the fucking English language. Athlete has two syllables. It's not athlete. And I know that may sound nitpicky, but when you're listening to a guy talk for 5 hours, it would be nice to hear him speak properly. I don't know. Maybe I'm like a rambling idiot that mumbles and stumbles and doesn't pronounce words right, and that's why nobody listens to our podcast. But that's neither here nor there. Maddie?
It's extremely frustrating. It's grating as a listener. And it's just, I don't think there's any place for the heel commentary role in New Japan as it currently stands. You can do without it. I keep harping on this, but, you know, Josh Barnett and whoever is calling the match beside him, whether it be Mauro or JR on the Access shows, I mean, they call it straight up, and it's so much better. So much better.
And I feel like that Callis is trying to get himself over. And maybe it's just part of his heel character. How often do I need to hear him bragging about that he's buddies with Chris Jericho?
Or Kenny Omega, for that matter.
Yeah, because they're both from where is it that they're both from?
I think Winnipeg.
Yes,
Winnipeg. Like all three of them, Jericho too.
Yeah, they're all from Winnipeg. It's just it's obnoxious. And I'll say that I don't think Kevin Kelly is that strong of a play-by-play guy either.
Now, I realized this during, I think it was the junior heavyweight title match. And it had been grating on me for a while, but I finally pinpointed what it was. Kevin Kelly does this thing where he'll like throw out the name of a move, but he'll try to make it sound cool. Or like when Michael Elgin was fighting Cody and he goes, "Big Mike." It's like, I don't need to hear that from you. Like, you're supposed to be calling this straight up.
And I hate that.
You're the least cool person of all time. Like, I'm the least coolest person I know, but Kevin Kelly is the least coolest person anybody knows. Like, it's so grating.
Yeah, it's
Are you going to go super kick?
Yeah, when
it's so meta, it diminishes it trivializes these big spots that he's like, you know, just throwing over these weird goofy calls over top of it's really annoying.
And then when you have the comparison, you have the comparison of watching the Access show, and you have either Mauro Ranallo or you have Jim Ross. Jim Ross, who is the best ever, and Mauro Ranallo, who is the best other than Jim Ross. And I tell you, I mentioned this on the podcast a few weeks ago during the Anthony Joshua Vladimir Klitschko fight. It was on Showtime and Mauro called it. It was an amazing fight anyway, but hearing Mauro Ranallo calling a fight again and just his enthusiasm, his passion, it made me so happy to hear that. I don't know that I'm too keen to tune into a Bellator show, but it's awesome that Mauro is going to be working from Bellator, that he's going to be doing some more combat sports. Obviously, he's doing boxing anyway.
Yeah, I miss him calling pro wrestling, though. I really do.
Well,
real pro wrestling and not the sports entertainment nonsense either.
Yeah, I think
make that perfectly clear.
It's going to be interesting to see what happens with JR. JR was actually on Observer Live this week talking about doing the New Japan stuff, and he's pitching it hard. He's not shirking his responsibility as a pitch man for New Japan. And then JR has also openly petitioned to call the Brock Lesnar Samoa Joe match that's coming up at Great Balls of Fire. So we'll talk about that a little bit more later. JR wants to be out there calling big wrestling matches, and he's going to be, they're going to be next, I guess it's the week of the G1 shows in LA. Him and Mr. Barnett are going to be calling the big matches from Dominion, and those are actually going to show, I think those are going to show right before the, either they're going to show on Friday or they're going to show right before the G1 show on Saturday. They're going to do like the Omega Okada match, and then I think the junior title and the Intercontinental title match, which we're gonna talk about coming up shortly. But to sort of wrap this part up is I'm not impressed with the commentary on New Japan. I like having the English commentary. Listen, I used to be a basketball color commentator. I know how difficult it is. It's incredibly challenging, and especially to sit there and keep your focus for 3 or 4 or 5 hours, it's very, very hard. And especially in professional wrestling, where you're not just calling the action, but you're trying to tell a story and get over what's happening in the ring. There's not a lot of people that I think have really been good at being pro wrestling announcers. There's very, very few. So again, that just right there tells you how difficult it is, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. If you're not adding to it, you're taking away from it. I mean, that's as simple as that. People like JR, like Mauro Ranallo, they're so, like you said, they're so passionate about what they're doing, and they really know how to add gravity to the moment. And it's an amazing skill, honestly. Yeah, it truly is.
Yeah, it is. And you know, the thing about JR, JR is obviously experienced, but JR, even in his mid-30s, was already amazing. And all the proof you need is on the WWE Network.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't gone back that far. I know that he called like different Mid-South shows that are on the network. I'm sure that he was really good back then too. He's always brought that, like I said, that passion. That's the only word I can think of.
And even that old, but there's so even there's old.
He's a fan.
There's old Crockett / WCW stuff. Again, it's all there. It's worth checking out. On a side note, this is the last little moment of me drifting off in the weeds for right now. But since we're talking the network, I wanted to bring this up. WWE actually posted a bunch of old Bruno matches. And honestly, it's about time. They have a collection up because basically the guy that the company was built on for nearly 20 years, and they had basically none of his content on there. So you're not going to get a five-star match out of it, but it is an important part of wrestling history. So I highly recommend you go check that out. So let's move on to the Dominion card, which was from a late Saturday night, early Sunday morning from Osaka Joe Hall. I believe they had about, 12,000 people there?
That sounds about accurate, yep.
Which is pretty much the biggest crowd that they're going to get that's not like the Tokyo Dome. It was a packed crowd. I think the audience was actually pretty hot all night. And the New Japan crowds can be a little passive sometimes, but this was a really, really hot crowd for them.
Yeah, no question. It really sticks out as you know, something unique about this show, just how into it all the fans were. And some of their reactions sort of being surprising as far as you know, the way that they react to certain spots and certain wrestlers out there.
All right, so the first match is David Finlay, Tomoyuki Oka, Shota Umino, who is the son of who?
Red Shoes.
Yes, indeedy. Took on Hirai Kawato, Tetsuhiro Yagi, and Katsuya Kitamura. David Finlay, your BFF and boyfriend, and his team went over in this one. So firstly, Finlay is a really good wrestler. And it's probably time for him to step up. Maybe he needs to take an excursion now. But, you know, never mind Finlay for a second. New Japan has a pack of young lions that are all, like, really good. And one of my concerns with New Japan has been is that, you know, with, you know, except for, let's say, like, Okada and Omega, and you don't know Omega sticking around, but, like, Tanahashi and Naito, Kushida, a lot of those guys are getting up there in years, and they're beat up, Tanahashi in particular. Okada, well, I don't know how long Okada's going to last because he takes too many beatings, but it's good to see that they've got guys coming up. And, dude, Kitamura is going to be a huge, huge star. There's nobody else like him in that promotion.
Yeah, those big hit backhand chops that he was hitting in that match were fucking raunchy, am I right?
Yeah, and here's the thing about Kitamura. If you guys haven't seen him yet, he is a big, muscled guy. I don't know whose physique to compare him to. Maybe a little like Brock, but not, still, that's not quite it.
Or almost.
Oh, go ahead.
Bobby Lashley.
Lashley. I was going to say Batista. He's muscled like that. Mm-hmm. He was an amateur wrestler.
Yeah. There's a photo on, I think it was Tanahashi's IG, where it was him and Kitamura standing next to each other. And Kitamura had quite a bit of muscle mass, you know, on Tanahashi. Like, he looked small by comparison. So that's the type of the type of body that we're talking about here. The type of physique. It's intense.
So again, you don't have these crazy muscle dudes like that in New Japan. They tend to have, for the lack of a better term, much more natural physiques. They don't necessarily have like the super ripped midsections. A few of them do, like you know, Tanahashi is pretty crazy ripped. Basically, those guys aren't doing an Atkins diet. Let's put it that way. So anyway, Finlay ended up pinning Yagi with a uppercut off the middle ropes and then a stunner. Mr. Dave Meltzer gave this one 2.75 stars.
Which, that's pretty high praise for just a Young Lion match. That's pretty good.
Yeah, I think maybe people confuse the star ratings a little bit. I think any, you know, what to keep in mind is that a 2-star match is a good match. A 3-star match is an awesome match. And you start getting past that, you're starting to get into holy shit range. So, fortunately, the scale's changing a bit because we've had a couple of, we've had a couple of 6-star matches now, but, yeah, 2.75 is still really good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, by any stretch, especially considering their place on the card and what they were meant to do. I mean, they weren't supposed to go out there and light the house on fire, so right. It's good of them.
So the next match, we have another tag match. This was actually the show opener. Young Lions match was a prelim. So this one is Togi Makabe, Yuji Nagata, Tiger Mask W, and Tiger Mask beat Jushin Liger, Madibu Nakanishi, Satoshi Kojima, and Hiroyoshi Tenzin. And it was in 7:01. I have to tell you, every time I hear Jushin Liger's theme music, I just get crazy pumped. I kind of want to get up and dance every time I hear it.
That's how I felt about Sami Zayn's music for the longest time. He is actually that used to be my my alarm tone in the mornings for a year or so, probably.
Awesome. That's how you're just going to get up and start the day, is with the underdog from the underground.
Indeed, getting my ska in for the day. My daily dose of ska action, if you will.
So talk to us about the match a little bit.
So as usual, I made mental note of the fact that the original Tiger Mask had a Tiger Driver and a much larger opponent. I believe it was Kojima this time. I tend to always think that Makabe should be higher on the card when he's working these multi-man matches. His battle with Ishii from Wrestle Kingdom 9 always sticks out in my head because it was my initial impression of him. I just know that he's capable of so much more, even though this card was absolutely jacked. There wasn't much space for him high on the card, but
yeah, remember,
he's still so talented. Like this talent pool is so deep, right?
I was going to say, not everybody can be at the top of the card at the same time. And, you know, Makabe is a former IWGP heavyweight champion. So you just got to rotate guys in and out. Like I said, not everybody can be in the main or the semi-main at once. So he's not going anywhere anytime soon.
Right.
It's cool to see Tiger Mask W back. Had a cool spot where he hit a double Pele kick on the Tenkozy duo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's such an awesome athlete as well. Just amazing. Amazing agility and everything that he's able to pull off.
So Makabe's team went over when Makabe dropped the King Kong knee drop on Nakanishi. And Mr. Meltzer gave this one 2.75 stars as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's about where... Yeah, that's appropriate, I would imagine. That's about where I would have had it.
So the next,
and did you catch the little Tiger Mask W doing the backflip off the apron afterwards?
Yeah, and the other guys were kind of jawing at him at the end of the match. Did you notice that?
Yeah, so he kind of like did it behind their backs, and you know, gave the crowd a little something extra. That was kind of cute.
Yeah, and it's actually was funny. I think I can't remember if it was Callis or Kevin Kelly that referred to Tiger Mask W as a young man, and we're kind of pretending that he's not Kota Ibushi. Dude, Kota Ibushi's not young. I think he's about the same age as I am, or pretty close.
Yeah, he looks so youthful though, just between his physique, and he's got a young looking face. So,
well, you know, it's
easy to mistake him for being much younger.
It's the same thing with Kushida. Kushida looks like he's about 12 years old. You know, like I said, he looks like,
yeah,
as we've said about, you know, he looks like Krillin. The dude's 34 years old. Mm-hmm. You know, hopefully, I think Kushida's still got a lot of years in him. But on to the next match, we had the, this is a gauntlet match for the never open weight six-man tag titles. This is a match like this is a little hard to talk about, but we'll figure out how to do this. It started off with, go ahead.
I enjoyed it quite a bit. I like how they sort of cycled everybody in. Everybody got their stuff in. And we had a logical progression of a heel team fighting a face team, the way that they sequenced the eliminations. You know, it was really well put together, I thought.
Yeah, so my thing with a match like this, and this is something I'm critical of WWE for, so I will be critical of New Japan for this as well. I don't know why this just couldn't have been a three-on-three match between the LIJ guys and the Taguchi Japan guys. And they're doing it to get everybody on the card. And you want to make sure your guys are getting paid, but at the same time, you know, it's your second biggest show of the year. If you don't have a spot for somebody, you don't have a spot for somebody. I don't necessarily like, you know, you have, what is this, you know, you have like 5-6 teams. You have like basically what ends up being like a 25-30 man match. There was some fun stuff in here though.
Yeah. I mean, I understand it. Like you said, you want to get as many people on the card as possible. And this is obviously their attempt to do that. But all things considered, it was better than like a gigantic battle royal or something stupid like that. So
yeah,
I thought it worked well.
Battle royals.
So yeah, we start out.
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay. Oh yeah, we start out with the Bullet Club guys. Your man, Mr. Takahashi. Not Hiromu, but Yujiro.
And so Angie is sitting next to me on the couch when Yujiro comes out. And I'm like, and I'm excited because I love Yujiro, right? And I'm like, dude, check it out. It's a Tokyo pimp. We're totally going to get to see him in Long Beach. And then he's got his girls with him. And she's like, uh-huh. So this is why you watch this.
I love that. You know what's coming next before.
It's like, it's, you know, New Japan totally does not ever do TNA stuff except with Yujiro. And it's just like, just, you know what? Let me have my Tokyo pimp. Okay. Let's just please leave me with that.
Yeah. And that's really all you need. You don't need it in every other segment. So, you know, it works in this one spot on the card. It's no different than, you know, the opponent in this match, Toriano. Like, he's the one comedy goofball guy and, you know, he makes it work for his spot in the card.
Yeah, so go ahead. Oh, so
a little bit of variety is a good thing, right?
Yep. So yeah. So the match starts off with the Bullet Club. So you have Bad Luck Fale, the previously mentioned Yujiro Takahashi and Hangman Page taking on the gents from Chaos. So Toru Yano, who I believe you told me earlier in the day is your spirit animal. Tomohiro yes. Ishii and Yoshihashi.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, starting out with this match, the main thing that sticks out is, you know, Ishii getting some pretty good shine early on. He was able to clothesline Bad Rack over the top rope to the outside, and he was, you know, throwing headbutts, just being his natural tank self, and it worked really well for the context of the match. And then we end up getting the elimination here with Toriano. He gets tagged in. He yanks the turnbuckle padding off. And, you know, his usual shenanigans. And he ends up getting a double low blow on two of the Bullet Club guys and a roll up for the win.
So out next comes the Suzuki-gun guys. So you have Zack Sabre Jr., Taichi, and Kanemaru. Of course, you know, Kanemaru has a whiskey bottle that he's trying to use in the match. This next fall goes quick. Yano goes for the low blow on Zack Sabre. It gets blocked, and Sabre ends up pinning Toru Yano, so the Chaos guys are out. Which leads us to the Taguchi Japan guys coming out. So Ricochet, Raisuke Taguchi, and Juice Robinson. Talk about the baseball spot they did.
Oh, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, talk about the baseball spot.
Oh, yeah, that was pretty cool. You had Ryusuke Taguchi, the player coach, if you will, calling the shots, playing the catcher role. They had, was it Taichi in the bottom corner? I forget who it was. One of the Suzuki-gun guys is laying on the bottom turnbuckle like he was getting ready for a Bronco Buster or something, if you will. And, yeah, so they called the play, and I believe it was Ricochet wound up, and Juice Robinson charged in with a cannonball.
Yeah, it was
right into the corner, and Taguchi got out of the way just in time.
Yeah, it was a fun little moment of them doing the baseball spot there, where, you know, Juice and Ricochet are both running into the corner. Taguchi calling for the fastball. It was, I don't know. I enjoyed that. It's, you know, normally.
Yeah, the little hand signals. Yeah, it was cute.
I don't like the comedy stuff constantly. I do appreciate the little moments that Taguchi does with the guys.
Yeah, he makes it work as well. He is pretty much the only other comedy guy. I mean, I said that about Toriano, but I guess there's two of them. And they're just the other two guys who do that stuff. It's their niche, and they really work well with it. They're veterans. They've been around for a long time, and that they get away with that type of thing.
Yep. So the match, though, this fall ends when Kanemaru tries to spit whiskey in Juice's face, but he missed and ended up going in Taichi's. Then Juice pins Taichi with the pulp friction. But the heels, being jackass heels that they are, because the Suzuki Gun Goon guys are the most evil motherfuckers on the planet, Zack Sabre Jr. put Juice in the Royal Octopus hold. And then Weiss, it's just, these British guys are just so fucking nasty with their submissions. He has him in the Royal Octopus hold. While he's doing that, he's like grinding on his ribs with his elbow, like getting down in between his ribs with his elbow. Then starts cranking back on his... There's actually some really nasty submissions all throughout this card. So Juice ends up getting beat up pretty bad. And the LIJ guys... Yeah, the LIJ guys come out next. So these are the who are the holders of the Never Openweight title. So Sonata, Evil, and Bushi.
Yeah, I gotta love Evil's entrance coming out. As Sabre's got that octopus hold locked in, being real extra raunchy with it. And, I love Bushi. Like, I got mentioned to you, if I were to make a created wrestler in, like, a Fire Pro game or something, that's what my guy would look like.
Is Bushi?
It is. Yeah, I love, or not Bushi, Evil, Jesus. Evil. Yeah. That just, that robe, that mask, the whole deal with the laser light pointers and everything, it's really cool.
You saw the picture I shared on the Facebook page of, I believe it was Hiromu and Evil as young lions.
Yes, Watanabe.
It's like, oh yes. My god, you guys are so cute. Although even
it is, it's ridiculous. Like they barely look like the same people. It's funny as hell.
Although what's funny though is that Hiromu still looks like kind of a pervert.
He does. He does got a little something in his eye going on there that's just unmistakable. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So the faces are in trouble here because of Juice being hurt. We get a hot tag from Ricochet with him doing a springboard missile drop kick, and he also hits a six.
I like the spot that.
Go ahead.
I like the spot that he does with the. I believe it was Sonata and Bushi. Sonata and Evil. Jesus. I think he threw Sonata into Evil into like a front face lock, and then he did the neck breaker to Evil, and Evil brings down Sonata with him into a DDT. Like, yeah. He's done that quite a few times in these multi-man tag matches, but it always looks really smooth and crisp when he's able to take on two guys at once. It's a pretty cool spot.
Yeah, Ricochet is next level. There was a... Tower of Doom spot, I don't know if you remember this, where there was a superplex and Ricochet was supposed to end it with a power bomb, and Ricochet nearly got his ass knocked out from that.
Yeah, he took one of Sonata's legs right to his... Well, it looked like it barely grazed his head, but it hit mostly his shoulder and his neck. Yeah, that could have been a lot more ugly if it would have been just a couple inches either way.
Let's see.
Yeah, pretty risky spot.
So the heels end up going over here when Bushi ends up pinning Taguchi with the MX. They did a nice spot with Taguchi having the ankle lock on Bushi. They really played that up well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought it was going to be over when Taguchi hit that Dodon. And the other two LIJ guys ran in at the very last second and broke it up. And then from there, it was pretty much... pretty much over. Sonata had that skull end locked in, and was able to set up with the MX that way. It was pretty cool. Little setup there.
And Mr. Dave Meltzer gave this one 2.5 stars.
Yeah, sounds about right as well. None of these matches were bad by any stretch of the imagination.
Yeah, there's not a single bad match on
anything over 2 stars. Anything over 2 stars is going to be at least decent, so... Yep.
Okay, so now we're in the part where the shit just starts getting cray.
Yes, indeed. So and it's so early on still. We've had 2 matches, and now, match number 3, we're already getting into amazing territory.
So we have the Young Bucks challenging Roppongi Vice, Rocky Romero, and Trent Beretta for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight titles. This is a rematch from a match on... at Wrestle Kingdom this year, where the where RPG Vice ended up beating the Bucks. They did an angle in that match where Beretta was injured, so Rocky had to carry the load themselves, and they ended up going over. So they did the reverse here, where Rocky gets taken out of the match early, and it ends up being Beretta having to survive on his own.
Yeah, and the Bucks said some really nasty shit to set up for that with the two apron bombs and slamming Rocky's back into the corner post a few times. So really, really dastardly looking shit from the Bucks here.
This was, I'm very critical of the Bucks. It's criticism out of I don't want to go so far as to say criticism out of love. I completely recognize their talent. I just think they're too meta. They're brilliant businessmen and brilliant performers, though. This is one of their best matches that I've ever seen. This was a great, great match from them. I'll actually even go ahead and leave my one niggling criticism out of this. Match ended up ending, and was there any more detail you want to go into before I dive into the finish?
Just the one thing that really stuck out to me was how when Rocky finally gets back up on the apron after selling for all those spots on the apron and the outside, he got beat up so bad. Brett is finally getting things going back his way, and he goes for that hot tag, and I think it was Matt Jackson picked Rocky up off the apron, ran him halfway down the ramp, which is a pretty long ramp, and powerbombed him right there in the middle of the ramp. A great heat spot. Great heat for the Bucks for that.
When Rocky ended up back in the match, though, I mean, I'm a big fan of Rocky. I mean, he's a badass man. So.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Matt ends up with Rocky in a sharpshooter. Rocky actually gets out of it a couple times, actually countering the sharpshooter with a small package once. But they end up hitting him with the Indy Taker, and Matt finally gets a submission on Rocky. Match length was 14 minutes, 14 seconds. Mr. Dave Meltzer gave this one 4 stars.
Yeah, that seems appropriate. Really, really awesome match overall. I don't think I really have anything else to add to that. It was just really, really good stuff. The Bucks working some good psychology into a tag match is always refreshing. I know that they're capable of it, and they really, took advantage of it here. So, awesome stuff.
So, the next match up was for the IWGP Heavyweight Tag Team titles. You have the Gorillas of Destiny, Tama Tonga, and Tonga Roa, or Loa, depending on who you ask.
Right.
Who are the sons of Haku, challenging War Machine, Raymond Rowe, and Hansen. Maddie, tell us about this match.
This one just was really chaotic and frenetic, and I mean that in the best way possible. I loved, just everything that these guys did, just coming in and out with the frequent tags and frequent tandem offense. It was really awesome to behold. I always love War Machine from the first time I've seen them, and Gorillas of Destiny are really growing on me the last few events, really starting to get really high on them as well.
Well, Tonga has got a lot better really quick, and I think Tama has just a killer look and vibe about him. As you said recently, they're like the Usos with upgrades.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, their entrance theme, I've been gushing over it for the past few days, since Sunday when I watched the event, actually. I added it to my iTunes library, my Apple Music library, and I've just been listening to it all week.
Nice. So, Howard, tell us about the end on this one.
So we had a spot where I believe it was Raymond Rowe had a chair and he was considering using it on Tama Tonga. And then out of nowhere, Tonga Loa comes in and bashes the chair over Rowe's head a couple times. And that led to the guerrilla warfare finish.
And
I thought for sure they were going to go with a magic killer, but at first it's a very similar setup.
Yep. So we have new IWGP Tag Team Champions. This is the second title change of the show. Mr. Dave Meltzer gave this one 3.5 stars.
Yeah, pretty good stuff. Nothing too crazy. Probably not as good as the junior match, but still really serviceable for its spot on the card.
So up next, we have the American Nightmare, Cody, taking on Michael Elgin. Cody, after his last singles match, had been basically called out for a bigger challenge. So they've been slowly moving up Cody up the card since he joined New Japan back in January. So we can, you kind of referred to this earlier in the show about Kevin Kelly kept shouting "Big Mike" during this match, mm-hmm. which that's all.
It's obnoxious. Yeah. And the same thing in the junior tag match, super kick.
Yeah, just that stuff needs to. He needs to be a professional. So,
exactly.
A lot of this match ended up being Cody being really arrogant and then getting himself in trouble for it, and then Elgin one-upping Cody and making him look stupid, including a crazy spot where Elgin held Cody up in a vertical suplex for about 20 seconds.
Yeah, I would imagine that a move like that would rely a lot on the core strength of the opponent. And obviously the fact that Cody was able to keep it up there for so long, yeah, that was pretty intense stuff. Cody is still working that sort of WWE style. Might be a little bit amplified from what he was doing, like on a typical SmackDown or something.
Well, he's showing
he's a good athlete, but
he's showing a lot of stuff that he never would have done in WWE. But you're right, I still do feel like his matches are very WWE style. But again, there's some very athletic and sort of like high flying stuff that he's doing that I don't really think was a part of what he had done before.
Yeah, he did at one point sort of a springboard drop kick. Yeah. It was towards the corner, but the way that he jumped up, it was sort of a springboard type of move, which was more than I had seen out of him on, you know, WWE television for sure. So that was pretty cool. And like you said, him being that arrogant character, he's really good at that, even though it led to his detriment in this match a lot of the time. He does sort of have that Randy Orton kind of stink on him a little bit, but I still think at the same time he's surpassed him by any stretch as far as actual match quality goes.
Yeah, he's working to get better, to expand his style. Cody ends up winning this one with a crossroads in about 12 minutes. Dave gave this one 3.5 stars. I can't say I agree with that. I like Cody. I openly admit that he's improving, but I didn't think that this was that amazing of a match. And by the way, I love Michael Elgin is fucking amazing though.
Yes, I've been a big fan as well. Ever since he started showing up like around this time last year, more regularly, I was a big fan. Yeah.
And I would suspect he's going to get...
I wish that he could.
Well, he's already had...
Go ahead.
I was going to say he's already had an IC title reign. I would expect big things from him in the future in New Japan.
Yeah, I'd like to see him make another run for, if not the IC title, at least the never open weight belt would be cool.
Well, no, dude, I want to see him in the ring with Okada.
Yeah, well, yeah, that would be... for sure the best course of action, but I think he's got some climbing up that ladder to do first. But we'll see.
Agreed. So next match, and this is things start getting really heated now. And then this is like you've already had like a really good wrestling card, and then this is where Overdrive gets kicked in. So the next match is Kushida challenging Hiromu Takahashi for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight title. Now, if you remember earlier this year, Kushida was challenging Takahashi for the title and got beaten about, 2 minutes. And then at Best of the Super Juniors, Kushida ended up losing his first two or three matches. So he started off in a deficit, ended up winning his block and then faced Ospreay at the finals of the Best of the Super Junior. That happened while we were off, so we haven't talked about that match. But Kushida and Will Ospreay had just a match for the ages in the Super Junior final. Kushida won that match, which is what put him in the position to challenge Hiromu for the title.
And it's a really good story that they told leading up to this match, too, with the amount of the early losses that Kushida had in the tournament and the G or in the best of Super Juniors rather, and just to be able to come back and make that final match and show a more vicious streak in doing so. So it really showed that he's, you know, prepared to take on Hiromu now and anything that Hiromu might bring at him, whether it be, you know, more nefarious or more legit. You know, we've seen a lot more of a vicious mean streak from Kushida, and it's really worked for him, I think.
I agree.
It's cool how they've brought it out in him over time.
So this match started off hot. It was a brawl, guys trading elbows and chops. There's some really wicked spots in there. You have the sunset flip powerbomb to the floor. You have Kushida doing different high spots with his submissions. Actually, talk about that spot with the chairs.
With the chairs, oh my god, yeah, that was probably my favorite spot of the match. Kushida grabs a couple chairs from ringside area, and the fans start booing him. They, you know, they want no part of this side of Kushida. And instead of, you know, just whacking Hiromu upside the head with a chair, he sets him up out into the crowd behind the barricade, and he does a sort of Sabu-esque double jump drop kick right into Kushida or into Hiromu's chest, and knocks him back a good 2-3 feet, I'd say at least, off the impact. It looked really awesome.
The crowd did not like this. This was an anti-heel crowd, and it didn't really matter who on this show was showing some heelish tactics. The crowd let them know that they didn't like it, that they wanted to see a fight, but they wanted to see a clean fight.
Yeah, exactly. And it goes to show later on with some of the things that Kushida does leading up to the finish as well. You know, he goes for those two gigantic punches to Hiromu's throat, right to his neck. Those were really brutal looking, right?
Oh yeah, dude. Yeah, I'm cringing just thinking about it.
And then those Danielson stomps. Yeah, it was just goddamn.
Crowd didn't like that either. One of the things that Kushida does that I really like is the. He'll get that key lock in, the hoverboard lock in when they're up on the ropes. He basically, it's like a suplex. I call it an avalanche hoverboard lock is the name that I've given it. But I really I dig the hell out of that spot.
Yeah, as well as when he hit that new the small package driver, that Back to the Future as he calls it, off the second rope. That was amazing as well.
So. A lot of this match is Kushida is working the hoverboard lock, and the match ends up ending after Kushida does those Danielson spots. Kushida gets the hoverboard lock in, and they do a long spot of Takahashi keeps trying to get into the ropes. Kushida pulls him back, and then Takahashi eventually taps. Go ahead.
This was no ordinary hoverboard lock, though. Kushida really wrenched it on with some more small joint manipulation there, and it looked extra vicious.
Yeah, the way he does some stuff.
It was as nasty.
He does some stuff with the wrist that hurts to watch, and we actually see a very similar spot later, actually in the next match.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's just crazy stuff. And I don't know, I mean... If we're being perfectly honest, I don't know how many more times I want to see Kushida take a sunset bomb.
We can go ahead and retire that spot.
Yeah, that's just, it looks like a concussion, just, you know, personified.
And actually, I think his head actually bounced off the mat pretty bad when that happened.
Yeah, it looked like it.
I'm trying to pull that back up in my mind's eye. So in typical New Japan fashion... the next challenger for the title is set up when Bushi runs out and blows mist in Kushida's eyes. The camera work on this was actually brilliant because at first you can't see who comes up behind Kushida because he's busy getting the crowd doing the wave. Next thing you know, he's laying on the mat and there's Bushi. Then they do a replay and you actually see that Kushida got a face full of mist.
Yeah, brilliant camera work. You know, you have the perfect diversion to you know, cut away to the audience, and then, yeah, like you said, they cut back, and he's down. Yeah, it's just it's going to be a good match, I'm pretty sure. I haven't seen too much of Bushi's work, but he's definitely capable. I like that MX finish. He should provide a good program for Kushida coming out of this.
And we'll talk about that. Match in a bit. So Mr. Meltzer gives this 4.75 stars.
This was probably my favorite match aside from the main event. Obviously the main event is on a whole different level, but as far as the undercard goes, I would say this is probably my favorite match.
Yeah, this was an amazing match. One of my favorite matches that I've seen in a long time. I love the competitors. I love the story they told. Yeah, it was phenomenal. Mm-hmm. So next match is Hiroki Goto challenging Minoru Suzuki for the Never Openweight title in a Lumberjack Death Match. So each guy, growing up watching WWF, when they would do lumberjack matches, it would just be you'd have a pack of heels and a pack of faces, but they didn't necessarily come out with somebody. This match, because everybody in New Japan has a posse, Goto comes out with his Chaos crew. So it's Yano, Yoshihoshi, Jado, and Ishii. And Suzuki comes out with Desperado, Zack Sabre Jr., Kanemaru, and Taka. This is the most serious I've ever seen Toru Yano look. Was like waiting for this match.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've never seen him look anything approaching serious before, so a little change of pace.
So this was another really good match. It was really set up for Suzuki-gun to cheat, and that's what they did. There's not a lot of heels, real heels in New Japan, because even like Bullet Club and LIJ are pretty lovable. Suzuki-gun mm-hmm. are fucking bastards.
Yeah, there's nothing appealing about any of them. Aside from maybe Sabre Jr.'s mat work, but that's really it. I loved how we got the spot where the first time Suzuki faces any real jeopardy, he sticks his goons back on Goto in the middle of the ring. So Goto hits a Yushikiroshi on Suzuki. It's the first like really good offense he's gotten in the match at all, and then Suzuki responds by shoving Goto into the ref and then sending in the goon squad.
There's that moment. There's a moment where
sick bastard.
There's a moment where Suzuki is sitting in the ring by himself while everybody's brawling outside, and he's just sitting there laughing.
Mm-hmm. With his I don't want to say Indian style, so I say crisscross applesauce. He's in there just chilling and just loving every bit of it. We got the goons jumping in and beating down Goto. And who's the man to save the day? Who clears the ring?
Yoshihashi.
Our beloved hero of the day. Mr. Loose Explosion himself. Gotta love it, right?
So Suzuki goes over here with the Gotch pile driver. Yoshihashi ends up chasing
Taichi, that rotten bastard.
We'll get back to that in a second. I guess I'm going a little out of order. Yoshihashi actually ends up clearing the ring after the match. He's not a guy that I've necessarily thought of as like a big star or whatever, but they are giving him a push here. Taichi was not out at ringside for this match. Goto hit the GTR on Suzuki. Had a three count, but then Taichi runs out and pulls the ref out of the ring. At that point, the Chaos guys are at a disadvantage because they have an extra guy, and Taichi is just a rotten bastard who doesn't even know how to lip sync well. Actually ends up hitting Goto with a nasty chair shot, which I would never want to see a chair shot again, which resulted in Suzuki hitting the Gotch pile driver.
Right. So, once again, nothing likable about Suzuki-gun whatsoever. These guys are all just sick, sick, sadistic men. And, that goes over pretty well here for what they're trying to do. We get the brief little promo by Suzuki out on the ramp. And Yoshihashi actually, you know, charges after the Suzuki-gun guys, and the KS faction has to jump in and you know, pull him apart from jumping them by himself. So, yeah, Yoshihashi. I never would have taken him seriously either, but, you know, here's, I guess, the start of big things for him, so we'll see how it goes.
So Dave Meltzer gave that one 3.5 stars. Again, I agree. It was a spectacular match. Up next, had the semi-main event. And after you've seen this match, you're probably thinking that nothing would top this, but we'll get to that. So Hiroshi Tanahashi, the ace of New Japan, perhaps the best wrestler in New Japan history. We could throw that up in the air if it's him. Is it Antonio Inoki? Is it Shinya Hashimoto? Is it Riki Choshu? Is it Tatsumi Fujinami? I think it's Tanahashi challenging Tetsuya Naito for the IC title.
Yeah, that punk-ass Naito tossing that IC belt around all over the place.
And so coming into this...
He busted that thing up, didn't he? I mean, that belt was just busted up.
It's in bad shape. It's missing a bunch of pieces. Naito actually said in an interview before the match that if he had won this, he was going to get New Japan to retire the belt because he thought there were too many belts and that the IC belt had no point.
Right, and you know, to his point, there are an ass load of championship belts in the promotion right now, and they're about to add another one. So
yeah, I mean, thankfully,
again, it's that thing where the heel might be justified in their point. So.
Yeah, so thankfully all the belts get defended and they act like they matter. But yes, there are too many fucking belts. This match started off hot. Tanahashi jumped Naito before the match even started. Naito is still in his super pimp-ass purple suit. Tanahashi, who is working with a torn biceps, had a heavily taped up right arm, which played pretty heavily into the match. Naito was working that the entire time.
Yeah, that one submission that Naito locked in, he had the left arm of Tanahashi hammerlocked with his legs, almost like an omoplata, if you will, and then had that right arm barred behind his back and digging in that elbow into that bicep. That was probably the nastiest looking submission hold of the night, out of a night of many. I thought that might have been the ugliest one.
So Tanahashi was a little nasty in this match, which I wouldn't expect him. Actually spitting on Naito at one point.
Yeah.
It just,
yeah, yet once again the crowd booing the less than, you know, dignified tactics from any of these faces.
Yeah, so Tanahashi ends up working Naito's right leg a lot, doing his dragon screw. But you notice he starts having problems because he uses his right arm to do the dragon screw. So you notice that he's having problems with it. And Don Callis actually made a rare good point that he thought Tanahashi was going to need to switch to his left arm for his dragon screw.
Yeah. He does do more of like an analyst role here in this match. That's the one upside to Callis. Yeah, he was starting to turn around a little bit here. But yeah, and you can imagine just, you know, with that tear right above the elbow, like they were saying, it's just, it could not be easy to do anything with it, right? Let alone compete a wrestling match. So yeah, crazy stuff.
So Naito actually ends up kicking out of the high fly flow, which just isn't a thing that happens. So Tanahashi ends up putting Naito in a clover leaf. And this is the nastiest clover leaf I've ever seen. Remember how, especially early on, when Jericho first started doing the Walls of Jericho, and he would just basically sit on the back of the guy's head? That's what Tanahashi did here.
Very similar to that. Yeah, he had those legs elevated about as high as he could. Naito's neck is lying on the mat and his head's all twisted to the side. This looked absolutely agonizing. Just incredible stuff from Tanahashi here. Probably one of the best forms I've ever seen on a clover leaf.
So Naito ends up tapping. Tanahashi regains the IWGP Intercontinental title. This one went nearly 26 minutes, and Mr. Dave Meltzer gave this 4.5 stars.
And Tanahashi is just, you know, still such an over baby face, too. It's amazing the amount of crowd reaction he gets after the match on the way back up the ramp. You know, the fans throwing the towels at him, and it's just, it's a sight to see.
Yeah, them throwing the towels, he wipes the sweat on him, tosses him back. Like, you know, he's basically Elvis, apparently. And for a sec, I thought he actually got tossed some underwear, but I think it was just like a shirt or something.
Probably. I wouldn't be shocked if there were panties thrown, though, if we're being perfectly honest.
So up next, we have the main event, the rematch of what some have called the best match ever in the history of professional wrestling. Kazuchika Okada defending his IWGP heavyweight title against the cleaner Kenny Omega.
Yeah. I don't even know what to say, where to start with this.
So it's hard.
So much.
It's hard to talk about. It's like, it basically, it's kind of be like trying to sit here and summarize Moby Dick, you know, or War and Peace.
God damn.
I don't really know how much I can actually break this down. There's some nasty spots like Okada hitting Omega with a Death Valley driver on the apron, which was just fucking brutal.
Same with the elbow drops, the elbow drop on the outside through the table. That didn't really break the table, but it left a good crack in it. Those tables that they use in New Japan are not gimmicked at all. So anything that they do on those just looks absolutely brutal.
So Kenny ends up getting hit with several rainmakers, and he's in bad condition. He's just sort of throwing weak punches. He's almost crying, right? I mean, it's like a really like powerful moment. Like he's like in a bad spot. And a big, big moment in the match happens where the entirety of Bullet Club comes out and Cody has a towel and is wanting to throw it in. The Bucks, who seconded Omega on this match, are stopping him. And what's interesting is that the rest of Bullet Club is trying to get the Bucks to basically saying, hey, look at Omega. We need to stop this match. He does not, and Omega rallies out of nowhere with one of his jumping knees and then a reverse Hearn Kinrana.
Yeah, we've talked about this a little bit just with the things that we've seen, like with Adam Cole in the Bullet Club and, you know, working matches with the Elite. It seems like it's rather apparent that the Elite's going to break off here.
I think we're
the first one to really make it explicit recently.
I think we'll talk about it.
It's been kind of in the background for a while now.
And we'll talk about that a little bit more when we sort of move on to the talking about the upcoming matches. But I think a break is coming between the Elite and Bullet Club. And I'll be curious to see if anybody, like if maybe Marty Scurll goes with the Elite or whatever. But so shortly after this, Omega hits the One-Winged Angel for the first time. And I actually thought the match was over at this point. And Okada got his foot on the rope. This is the first time. This is the first time in their matches that Kenny Omega has hit the One-Winged Angel on Okada.
And everybody had to assume that it was over the way that they had been putting that move over, that the finish, that One-Winged Angel finish. So it would have been hard to imagine it not ending the match, and then we get that foot on the rope. Like you said, the way that he picks up that package pin, you know, it's a rather novel way to put the foot on the rope as well. So
a really cool spot in the match where Okada goes for the Rainmaker. When he tries to pull Kenny back forward, Kenny just collapses, and then Okada still swings his arm really hard and basically ends up tossing himself into the corner because there's nobody there to hit with the arm. So the match goes to a draw, a 60-minute time limit draw, which is something that you never see in this day and age. At the end, Okada had hit another Rainmaker, and he's crawling to try to get to Omega in the time, but he didn't even get close enough for a pin attempt. So this is, again, 60-minute draw. They were a little slower at the beginning of the match than they were in their Tokyo Dome show, but this wasn't like, say, the Bret Shawn Iron Man match at WrestleMania. This was 60 minutes of action. They were not, they were going at it. I think this is the best match I've ever seen. I personally think it's better than the Tokyo Dome match. And to sort of summarize this card, I think this is the best wrestling show I've ever seen. And we'll see how I feel about it in a few weeks or a few months. But dude, I've been watching wrestling for 35 years. And I really think that this is the best card I've ever seen.
They know what they're doing. That's for damn sure. Every match felt like a big deal. They all felt like they had, personal grudges behind them. The amount of athleticism, the amount of risk taking that these guys, show forth just to put on a show for us. It's phenomenal all the way around. I'm not going to go that far with the absolutes, but I completely understand why you feel that way.
So, Meltzer gave this 6.25 stars and called this a modern version of the 89 Flair Steamboat series, which, if you haven't seen, is on the WWE Network, where they had, three big main event matches. Which is probably, one of the best trio of matches you're ever going to see. And I'm assuming we're going to see this again later this year.
Yeah, this can't be the end of it. There's no way that they're going to leave it at that.
So, after the show, in his part of the press conference, Kenny basically said that, basically said that he was going to rebuild himself from the ground up, and he wasn't leaving New Japan until he beat Okada.
Wow. That's a bold statement. It's going to be a huge momentous event when it actually happens. So I'll be looking forward to that, but, that might be quite a ways off yet.
So coming up in the New Japan schedule, they have, before the G1 shows in the U.S., they have their Kizuna Road tour. And a lot of those, several of those shows are just your typical house shows with the multi-man tag matches. But they are doing three Kurikan Hall shows, which have some title matches in it. So on the June 20th show, you have another match for the NEVER Openweight 6-man tag titles. You actually have Kushida, Juice, and Rusuke Taguchi taking on the champions, Bushi, Evil, and Sonata. Which is interesting because if you jump ahead a few days to the show on June 27th, which is actually 2 days. Well, no, it's not 2 days. It's the Wednesday before. Is that right? Is that the Wednesday before? No, the Tuesday before the LA shows, the main event of that show is Kushida being challenged by Bushi for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight title. And the day before that, you have Yoshihashi challenging Minoru Suzuki for the NEVER Openweight title.
Yeah, those should all be pretty good matches. Really looking forward to seeing what Yoshihashi puts forth. Should be interesting. The 6-man match makes sense. That was probably the most heated feud coming out of that match for those trios titles. Kushida's going to have an awesome match with Bushi. There's no doubt in my mind.
So, After that, on Saturday, July 1st and Sunday, July 2nd, you have the G1 shows in Long Beach, California. It's actually funny. I'm looking at the lineup right now on New Japan's English site, and they spelled Los Angeles wrong. And it's not in Los Angeles anyway, but it's in Long Beach. Excuse me. So let's run over the cards for this real quick. There's some awesome stuff, and there's some less than awesome stuff. So on the Saturday show, 10-man tag match, you have members of Chaos. You have Beretta, Romero, Will Ospreay, and then you have them boys, Mark and Jay Briscoe, taking on the Bullet Club. So the Young Bucks, Marty Scurll, Yujiro, and Bad Luck Fale. That promises to be a fun match, I think.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Like I said, when you said you were going to that New Japan show, I thought that was cool. And then they added all that ROH talent and the Briscoes in particular. That's just, you know, such an awesome little tasty bonus there.
I agree. And that's all I will be in the, that's the night I will be in the front row. So I will.
Oh, you sick bastard.
Indeed. So the next match, we have an 8-man tag match. And this is a really cool lineup here. You have three guys from CML. So you have Titan, Dragon Lee, and Volador Jr. teaming up with Jushin Thunder Liger. And that's just a fucking team right there. I love that. And they're taking on members of LIJ. So taking on Hiromu Takahashi, Bushi Evil, and Sonata.
Yeah, rather interesting. Those guys, you know, with all that luchador experience, that's going to be a promise to be a pretty high flying match, I'm sure. Really cool stuff. You got a lot of juniors in there. Should be able to tangle with the luchadors. Awesome.
Indeed. So, also on Saturday, the IWGP U.S. Heavyweight Title Tournament starts. So first round match, we have Jay Lethal and Hangman Page. We also have Juice Robinson against Zack Sabre Jr. Later in the show, we'll come back to the rest of the card. You have Tomohiro Ishii against Tetsuya Naito, and which promises to be an amazing match, Michael Elgin and Kenny Omega. My guess is, you can pop online and take a look at the brackets. My guess is the finals will be Kenny Omega and Tetsuya Naito, with Kenny Omega winning. But we'll see. You have any thoughts on that?
That would be ideal. That's probably the best matchup you can get out of that tournament. I'm really excited to see that opening match, like you said, to Omega and Elgin. They had some excellent work last year when they feuded over the IC title. And it'd be a nice continuation of that for sure.
So also on the first night, have another 8-man tag match, which is Finley, Jay White, Kushida, and Hiroshi Tanahashi taking on Sho Tanaka, Yohei Komatsu, Yoshitatsu, and Billy Gunn.
Yeah, boy.
Yeah.
The one.
And we'll talk more about him in a bit. We have a rematch from Dominion for the IWGP Heavyweight Tag Titles. We have the Gorillas of Destiny, Tonga Loa and Tama Tonga, taking on War Machine, Hanson and Raymond Rowe. I would not be shocked to see a title change here to pop the U.S. crowd a little bit.
Yeah, good point. This match promises to be awesome too. It's straight from the second biggest show of the year into your, you know, lap. That's awesome.
Yeah. And the main event on Saturday night is Kazuchika Okada defending his IWGP heavyweight title against the American Nightmare Cody. Now, let me say, I don't think Cody was the best choice for this match. But he has been pushed very strongly in New Japan. He is, I think, fairly over. And it's Okada. Okada got an awesome match out of Bad Luck Fale, so he'll get an awesome match for sure out of Cody. Again, I don't think this was the best choice. I think maybe New Japan is mistaking what's going to be over with the American crowd, and we'll talk about that some more in a minute. But that being said, this will be a great match. I have no doubt about that.
Yeah, me either. I'm looking forward to see. You know, we've wanted to see Cody against some better opponents, and had a really good match with Elgin, and he should have, like you said, at least a great match with Okada. So this will be the first really big test to see how he, you know, goes over in these matches.
No, well, I mean, we're gonna see for certain if Cody can rise above being just a WWE mid-carder, like, you know, above being Randy Orton light, you know. And by the way, I do genuinely like Cody. I love what he's been doing. It's just not what I want to see in this spot. That being said, New Japan's not going to give away in their first trip to the U.S. a crazy title match, because, you know, they want to save those big matches for the home crowd. I totally get that. I still don't think it's an ideal match.
Right. And I don't blame you either. But it should still be decent enough. We'll see how he does.
So
it'll be a big test for sure.
On the Sunday show, you're going to have the remainder of the IWGP US title tournament. So two semifinal matches, and then the final match. And you have Tanahashi defending his IWGP Intercontinental title against Billy Gunn. This is fucking stupid, dude. Like, I'm trying to keep things in perspective. Like, listen, I'm going to see back-to-back nights of New Japan Pro Wrestling in Long Beach, California. One night I'm going with one of my best friends in the world that I haven't seen in like 6 years. The other night I'm going with like my amazing girlfriend. I have the financial ability to travel across the country and spend 5 days in Southern California. This like isn't a sacrifice at all for me to do this. So I'm keeping it in perspective before I start bitching about this. I'm very fortunate. What the fuck are they thinking? Billy fucking Gunn? You're talking about a guy who, even when he was at his best, was not any good. And I'll give him full props that he's been able to reinvent himself multiple times in just totally different gimmicks. He was one half of one of the best tag teams of the 90s. But he's not good. He's never been good. He's a guy that got pushed over and over again because of his look. He's 52, 53 years old now. There is literally nobody else on that roster, on the Ring of Honor roster, on the CMLL roster that they could have put in this spot. Like, dude, you couldn't have put Jay fucking Briscoe in this spot. You couldn't have put, I take Jay Briscoe, Mark Briscoe, dude, who else could you put in this spot from, put Hank.
Lethal.
Put Lethal. No, Lethal's in the tournament, so you don't want to put him in that.
Oh, is he? Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Lethal's in the tournament. You know, shit, dude, Dalton, give me fucking Dalton Castle in this spot.
Yeah. Yeah, no shit.
So
that would be preferred.
So New Japan is not going to overtake WWE, but they want to have a presence in the U.S. because there is potentially a ton of money for them to be made here. People want to see, this is, Todd Martin was talking about this last night. This is wrestling for adult males. And I think that's why we like it. That's why a lot of people, this is wrestling. And by the way, that's not to exclude women. I hope that there's women out there that enjoy this, but the target audience is adult men. Okay. And that's always been the wrestling audience. Whereas WWE will give you fucking wrestling bears, New Japan gives you professional wrestling, okay?
Exactly.
They're mistaking what this audience wants to see. They need to get a better consultant on the American side of things so they don't keep making these decisions. And by the way, guys, you want to talk to me? Hey, I'll let you know what an American wrestling fan wants to see. But and I can definitely tell you that it's not Billy Gunn. Now, it's Tanahashi, and even injured, he's going to get minimum a 3.5-star match out of Billy Gunn. Still not what I want to see. Still not what I want to see, and it's not what they should have booked. I'm not thrilled with the Cody match, but at least Cody has been pushed for the last 6 months in New Japan. Mm-hmm. Billy Gunn...
Yeah, it makes storyline sense, if nothing else.
This is like Jinder Mahal getting a title shot, is the Billy Gunn thing right here. The Cody thing is to a certain extent,
right,
because New Japan thinks, oh, well, we have to give them like an American guy. Because it's like, WWE thinks, oh, well, we got to give the Indian audience an Indian guy who's not Indian. He's actually from fucking Vancouver or some shit.
Yeah, he's from, where is it? Oh, no, I don't remember. Never mind.
Or maybe he's Calgary, from Montreal. But his point is Jinder Mahal's Canadian.
Right.
But to sort of put a little salve to soothe that wound a little bit, you know what we got, Maddie?
What's that?
Oh.
You tell me.
Well, we've got Roppongi Vice getting their rematch against the Young Bucks for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Championship.
Sick.
So that makes up for a little bit.
A lot of it, I would think. But that's just me.
So that's what we got coming up. So as I mentioned earlier, we're not gonna be doing a old match this week. We'll get back to that next week, but I really wanted to focus on Dominion in the upcoming shows. So one more thing I want to talk about, and then we're going to call this the show. We're going to talk about real sports again for a second. So Matt, August 26th, Conor McGregor is going to be facing Floyd Mayweather Jr. in a boxing match. And I've been telling people for months that this wasn't going to happen. And what I said was it's not going to happen until it happens. Like, I wasn't going to put odds on it. I'm like, this is not happening. Yeah. But if it happens, it happens. So, wow. What to say about this? Conor and Floyd Mayweather are both brilliant businessmen. They're both probably going to make, assuming people buy the pay-per-view, are going to probably both make 9 figures on this. I can't believe that any boxing commission would approve this match. Conor is going to get destroyed, Floyd's going to clown him. And the thing is that, you know, Floyd is super patient, but I think Floyd's going to actually knock him out. I really do. Conor's never going to lay a glove on Floyd. From a sports business perspective, from a promotional perspective, from a spectacle, as a spectacle, this is all very interesting. As a sporting event, this is dumb as fuck.
Yeah, it's not going to be a good matchup. And they better think of something to do with that undercard to make it interesting, or else people are not going to be happy with it.
Dude, it's all boxing.
This will probably be like the last super fight they can get.
It's all boxing. It's like fights promoted by Mayweather. So,
yeah.
So I can't. Conor probably has to be convincing himself that he can win. He is supremely confident, and he's got to train for this. But what's going to happen is that Conor is going to lose this fight. He's going to make $100 million, and he's never going to fight for the UFC again. And then what happens in the mainstream sports fans' eyes is that we'll see this UFC is a bunch of garbage. They're not real fighters. Boxers are still superior. It's going to diminish the UFC brand. So number one, generally in the casual fans' eyes, they're going to look lame. They're going to lose their biggest star, because I tell you, Conor McGregor, if he fights Floyd Mayweather, is never fighting for the UFC again. Lay money on it. That's what's going to happen. This is going to do very real damage to the UFC brand. Conor, in my opinion, is going scorched earth here. He's going to get his last big payday, and I don't know if this is... He's always kind of fucked with UFC constantly anyway, and he's apparently done with them. Like I said, to me, this is scorched earth.
Yeah, and you know, the thing is, he doesn't owe them shit, though. I mean, let's be real.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't.
Let's not. They haven't done him any favors over these years, you know. So, on one hand, it's understandable, but yeah, it's not going to look good. That's not going to be a good look. And you know, it's funny because yeah, I mentioned the James Toney, Randy Couture fight to you. Like, you know, if they were doing an MMA match, it would look the exact opposite. Conor would just wreck Mayweather in a matter of seconds. But you know, unfortunately, that's not what they're doing.
No, of course. I mean, Floyd's way too smart to ever do that. I don't think Conor cares about winning and losing. Conor cares about getting paid. So, and
yeah,
which incidentally is not the wrong approach. So, and for what it's worth, I am probably going to buy this match knowing what I'm going to get into, but I still need to see it anyway. So I'm guilty, very guilty here.
Yeah, I determined I'm not going to spend more than $10 on it. Like, if I can get 9 people together and we can all go in on it, $10 a pop, then maybe I'll do that. But I'm not dishing out more than that for this card.
All right, so Maddie, anything else you want to add about this match?
About this match, no. You know, it's unfortunate. You know, the UFC was just bought for $4 billion. So I don't know how they're going to be able to survive coming out of this, so be very interesting to see.
All right. So on that note, ladies and gentlemen, if you're enjoying the show, go give us a good review on iTunes. If you haven't subscribed to us, we're on iTunes, Google Play Music. We're on Stitcher. We're all over the place. If you want to find us online, we're on Facebook, Flying Gaijin Bombcast. We're on Twitter at FG Bombcast. On the web at flyinggaijinbombcast.com. Email is flying.gaijin.bombcast@gmail.com. You can find me on Twitter at the Zork. That's THEZ number 0 RK. You can find my band Northern Crown if you're into heavy metal. We are northerncrownband.com. Maddie, how can the people find you?
The people can find me a couple different places. One of them would be facebook.com/madmatt, which is spelled MADD.MATT.T. On Twitter, I am Albino Buddha, ALBINO_BUDDHA. And I'm also on Instagram, which is ThompsonMR90. So ThompsonMR90. Yeah, hit us up. Let us know what you think.
All right. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We will see you next week.